sang anugerah Akademi Negara. Dengan hormatnya, dijemput yang berbahagia Profesor Dr. Jarika Nguyen dari Universiti Putra Malaysia untuk menampilkan pementerangan yang bertajuk Learner Investment in Learning. Dipersilakan.
Kami, saudara-saudara sekalian, saya amat berbangga ada di UKM. Setiap kali saya datang di UKM, saya ingat 5 tahun saya mengajar di sini untuk program Masters di Pusat Bahasa dulu. Dan memanglah banyak saya, saya diri saya terbentuk di sini sebab Masters is a very crucial part of your education. Dan saya sangat-sangat bersyukurlah belajar di UKM untuk program Masters. Izinkan saya menggunakan bahasa Inggeris ya untuk meneruskan tentang ini sebab bidang saya memang pelajaran dalam bahasa Inggeris lah. Okay, my topic is actually learner investment in learning, and I'm very disturbed, very very disturbed by the fact that people do not consider it very seriously. I think the reason why people learn is for them to invest in their own learning. It's not for the teachers. So we find that a lot of teachers are doing the investments. So if you do the investments, you will reap the dividends. So what's the point of a teacher reaping dividends when the learning is supposed to be on you know, the learning should be on the part of learners. So that's what I'm disturbed about. A lot of people were apprehensive when I actually said that I conduct a lot of my work in MRSS. They said, why go to a good school? Why go to good schools, select schools? People who are already cream, semua A bawa masuk MRSS. Dan saya bagi tahu mereka bawa ramai casualties dalam bahasa Inggeris di MRSM, especially di Pantai Timur dan Utara. People getting A's for modern math, ad math, chemistry, physics, bio, you name it. English C, losing all the opportunities to go abroad. That's a form of discrimination, I tell them. So don't think that aiding schools which are out of town and normal day schools itself is enough. Yes, I have been involved in a lot of programs in Padang Temu, Melaka, for instance, many years ago. And I thought, well, it's not a real crisis situation here, as the people still speak a lot of good English in the town areas in Melaka. So where are the problem areas? Actually, the problem areas are all the East Coast and North, most of them. Many of them handicapped because of the harsh realities of the game. No teacher wants to serve very much in the East Coast and or in rural areas in the North or in East Malaysia, where they have to go to school by boats and things like that. Now, before I went to these schools, I had to train my teacher trainees first. I'm a teacher educator. I'm in the Faculty of Education Studies, UPM. And I teach primarily two subjects, two courses. One is teaching of writing. Oh, you know, I was inspired by teaching of writing because the UKM had the strongest faculty among all the universities in at the time when I was doing my MA here. And these are the people who actually inspired me to actually go into writing. But I also teach another course called English Language Teaching Materials. And I mean, there are lots of problems in writing, but let's not go into that first. But you know, why am I focusing on English Language Teaching Materials in this talk? Is that for the simple reason, the book as an artifact is one of the biggest contributors to all the problems in English language teaching. But is there an alternative? Well, do it yourself, DIY materials. An alternative, but teachers find that they're so caught up with work, And DIY requires a lot of personal sacrifice, energy, finances, which actually gets them all to actually compromise on their teaching. And when you compromise on your teaching, you're going back to the textbook. So how to actually go about breaking this vicious circle? Like, you know, you have to use some materials in the classroom. The best materials are not exactly the textbook. And yet, you have to compromise and say the other alternative actually leads to a lot of sacrifice. Most teachers can't have that kind of sacrifice in their lives, can't dedicate to that kind of sacrifice in their lives. And so you go back to the necessary evil. The necessary evil is the textbook. In my talk, I'm going to tell you, because it's only a 40-minute talk, I can tell you one way in which I go about improving learning teaching by allowing learner investment to be a dominant factor in learning. When learners invest more in their own learning, they not only learn the language, they learn how to teach themselves how to learn the language. So there are aspects of metacognition which are so, so very much infused into this. So what's so special about learner investment in learning? The learner gets more than the teacher. The teacher facilitates. Why should it matter? Because the crisis situation is so severe that 75% of our English language teachers have been known to be not competent in the use of English language themselves. Number two, if they base it on structural and grammar-based teaching, like textbooks recommend, you got poor models of the language used themselves. They themselves are poor models of language, you know? Grammar semua terapur dan sebagainya, and so you start doing structural practice, you are going to reinforce errors which will lead one day to fossilization, which is another important aspect worth considering when you're a language teacher. So that's why it's important. Okay? What research has shown about learning teaching in Malaysian classrooms, I'm not putting the references here because there's so many. Prescriptive approaches, teacher-centered, over-dependence on textbooks. So this is what I did. As a teacher trainer, I don't have direct contact with students. But my previous experience of more than 10 years as a school teacher has shown me this. Number one, the sekolah biasa, harian, the normal day schools, either they have teachers who are not competent in the language themselves, or they don't have teachers at all. When I went to Jengke in 1979 to teach, you can guess my age by now. When I went in 79, there was not a single English language teacher in the school. The last person who went in to teach quickly got political cables and got a transfer back to the city. So I went by bus to Tumelo and taxi sapu, which the driver waited until there were about 8 in the car until he moved. So I went, precarious journey, you understand? Dust everywhere, because those were the first few fell dust where the virgin jungles were felled. We suffered from pesticide poisoning all the time. There was no refrigeration, so the chili bowl that was put into our mee goreng and nasi goreng gave us runny stomachs. And all these things happened, but you see, because I was the first English language teacher, there was some form of teaching that was going on. So from 0% passes, it moved to 11% within a year. And by the time there was a contract British teacher, there were two teachers there, and it rose to 55%. You don't give people the opportunity, they are not going to make it in life. So this is a form of injustice as well. This is a form of discrimination as well. For the ones who don't have cables, they remain soldiers in Jhenka, 5 years. Understand? The only way we actually got out was I did my HSC every year. After 5 attempts, I got a good HSC, so I got out. Yes? And so I went, my first degree, I wanted art because I'm more of an artist than an English language person. So I asked for USM Fine Arts and they said, no, critical. Well, they suddenly realized English was critical, so they gave me English. I don't regret about it at all, you know, because your artistic intuitions and all that help in your English language teaching. So I am into teacher training, and I believe that the best way to actually prepare your students is to actually give them novel approaches. Of course, they will go into schools thinking, none of this is going to work, it's going to take up too much energy. I'll just be like all the other teachers in the staff room. Follow the flow. But my duty in life is to tell them what they think works and is effective. Second, I involve them in service learning episodes. Service learning is quite new in this country, but hopefully it'll catch on. I work on service learning in schools. Again, because day schools, you need about 1,000 letters before somebody officially gets back to you, and usually it's, well, we can't allow for this to happen in our schools. I use MRSMs again because I have direct contact with Mara HQ, and they allow my students to do service learning episodes in schools. While they are working on something, they try out on real students. Understand? So it's not like something that's got no attachment to coursework that's going on in university. At the same time, I have school attachments. So out of the 3 months, and this is not Latihan Pelajar in industry, you know? It's not that. It is beyond that. First year, I have students registering for school attachments. You know, so which means that the 3 months, summer vacation, you call it, the 3 months is not just 3 months staying at home and or working in a supermarket as an assistant. No, you spend 1 month in an MRSM. Again, day schools, we don't want to disturb because they are already stressed. Understand? So we don't want to stress up the system further by bringing our students there. So we have the 3 layers in this kind of approach. And I feel that this has done wonderful things, not just to my teacher trainees, but also to the schools themselves. 2 publications out of this showing the dramatic rise in teacher confidence, dramatic rise, and also learner achievements at the SPM level, because we start with the Form 4s in the MRSMs. So how do I go about actually training my trainees, my future teachers with regards to this? First of all, you see, I feel that this is highly ironic. Undergraduates are subjected to actually a lot of unnecessary work as far as research, fundamentals of research concerned. Nobody starts from the basics, you know. There are so many publications that action research, yes, people are saying, oh my god, it's probably action research is also, you require a lot of inferential stats and stuff like that. And so they think that even action research is not accessible. So I usually start by telling my students, look, the simplest research, actually the word research itself is, if it's frightening, use inquiry. And the ways in which you can go is to look at a problem that exists, come up and identify what features of the problem make it such. Come up with a simple treatment procedure and see what happens. That's it. And at the end of the day, if you're in a materials course, you're looking at effective ways. If something doesn't work and you find out why it doesn't work, you're providing an alternative, you're testing the alternative, and then you're looking at ways in which adaptation can take place. Adaptation is an aspect of teacher professional development as well. Okay. I want to look you to have a look at a very simple, very, very simple problem. Actually, our textbooks are all aspects of complex problems. This is, I'm so thankful that this teacher voice can carry quite a far. This is a typical textbook page, a textbook that is now being used in Malaysian schools at Form 1. Okay? One look at this, what can you say about the textbook? You think it's maybe the rostrum requires me to go back?
Still not stopping, so okay.
So, one clear look at the first page. This is a Form 1 page book. The first page of a first unit of a Form 1 book. And it's about family. Alright? And I ask my students, I say, what do you think personally feel when you, if you were a 13-year-old or a 14-year-old secondary school student, how would you feel faced with this page? And these students are the ones who actually, when they told me that they, you know, they had similar textbooks when they were in school, I said, what about that? You know, how did you feel about that? They said, my God, they were the most boring classes ever. That was the, you know, the overwhelming voice of students actually indicated that this was boring. Why was this boring? They said, my God, none of these activities actually relate to young adults or adolescents. And it's, you know, you cannot be teaching it an adult class, let us say of 30-something, 40-something Japanese tourists using a standard one primary, I'm Mary, I'm John, that kind of textbook. Likewise, what you are looking at is a major flaw in terms of the principles of language learning, which actually says that one of the major factors in leading learners into learning is that content must be interesting. Okay? There must be aspects of what is known by Madsen and Bowen as early as 1978. Madsen and Bowen said that if material lack in situational realism, learning is stunted because the materials don't match the interests of the target group. In this case, you're looking at 13, 14-year-old young adults who believe that nothing here relates to them. Look at the features within young adulthood. And you will tell you that they are rebellious. They say no to most things. You know, they argue. But you know, all the contents in this book actually relate to this. Very submissive people. Okay? Playing together, 13, 14-year-olds. Washing the car, you know, the dads and the moms don't have to scream, but even the mom is involved in washing the car in this situation. Very unreal situations, and you know, there's a strong degree of lack of situational realism. Also, Ruth Weinrich, in her article, Death, Texas, and Jeopardy, did say this about situational realism, that anything that is deemed not positive enough will be omitted from textbooks. So there's no realism in textbooks. They are engineered families. This is on families, Unit 1, engineered families. But it's the same for all the other books. The Kementerian has got 3 textbooks because it covers 3 zones. The same here, okay? You find that kids are working with their parents
preparing for a meal, having a meal together, playing in the park together, watching TV together. Very unreal situations, uninteresting, cannot keep the attention of learners, and so deemed not effective because, you know, language is about engagement. Understand? Learners' engagement with teachers, learners' engagement with materials. So if you don't have that because your materials are not real, you're going to have that. Look at that. Good times together. Wonderful. Everybody's holding hands, taking photographs. If you think Malaysian textbooks are capable of all these problems, look at a textbook on family by a commercial publisher, Longmans. The same thing. It's not about language learning, it is about the concepts of family that they are interested in. In this case, a family tree. You see? This is where our learning teaching situation has gone wrong, because if you were a teacher who is spontaneous, what you would do is, the day before class, you tell them, okay, bring photographs from your home. And kids these days will put their heads up and say, my God, sir, it's difficult. Why? They've got 2 million photographs in their iPhones. You know? What you have done is create a task where they have decision-making power. And that decision-making capability is a very important aspect of task that they have to decide. Because the teacher has framed the task as such. You pick 10 of your family photographs which tell a very nice story about your family. Bring your 10 photographs to class, and then we will sit in groups of 5, and each of you take turns to tell the story of your family using the 10 photographs. And then at the end of it, the best family story, the person will stand up from the group and tell to the whole class. But before all that happens, of course, you bring, as a teacher, your 10 photographs, and you start telling about your story, about your own family. In that case, you actually are becoming the model, which is very important in language teaching. And this model that you are producing the scaffolding, the language that is necessary for your own learners to use later when they are producing their things about their own family. All this without the textbook. All this empowering the learner, telling the learner that the investment in this task is mostly on you. I developed the task, decision making on which 10 photos of your 2 million photographs that you have, you choose the 10, you come and tell a story the next day in the classroom, and then you start making this ownership yours. Nobody owns learning except the learner. That's the bottom point. And to make the point clearer is the fact that textbooks only say what is right. And what is learning, by the way? Is language learning divorced, detached from development, from personal development? So, if it is detached, what you're looking at is, okay, you're teaching a language, but are you teaching other things apart from language? You see, why this make-believe? Textbooks say everything is right, and like Ruth Weinrich says in her article, the systematic omission of death, Texas jeopardy. Nothing bad happens to people. In real life, that's not the case. So the next step forward, which I tell them to do, is to actually create a 1 minute, again, the discipline in the confinement of the task. Create a 1 minute video on your family, and that's project-based learning. And you watch 2 of these videos. I'll show it to you. All right? And the textbook will never actually allow students to get into reality. But look at my students' work. I won't show you the happy ones. Not that, but nothing against people being happy. But there's hardly any time, so I do the ones that really.
only thing that's right.
Really. So one student came to me and said, "Sir, I have a brother who is a drug addict and he's been jailed many times, and the story of his life is he finally died." And I said, "Oh my God, if you don't feel comfortable about putting this in your video, you don't have to do this. You know, you don't have to do this. There are certain kids who come out and says, I'm going to lie a bit about my family. It's not as happy as you think it is, but this is it." And there's so much of language, you know, there's so much of interaction between kids and yourself. It's just wonderful. Look at this student, how she escapes. She cheats. I always tell them the task is 1 minute. It is a 1 minute video about your family, because otherwise they'll come up with a Hindi film about 3 hours. Then you have to sit through it. You probably, you know, die from the exhaustion. But seriously, this one, she cheats because she's run out of time, and look at the strategies that learners use. But they tell you, you know why they tell you? While they are preparing this, they are constantly updating their blogs. So that's where I get this information of what they do as well. Okay, I'm learning as much as they do. Second, I need a little bit of tragedy into this story, because it's all fun and nice and everybody's having great fun, but the mother lost 3 babies and 2 in the family struck by cancer. I looked at her, Deborah, you seem to be bouncing all over. I said, that's me, sir. You know, that's me. I said, there are things that I cannot see because it's all my, you know, it's all muddled, but we are fighting and we are back on track right now. So don't worry about me, sir. That's interesting, isn't it? The first one, you notice that it was all in color at first, the wedding photos and everything. Suddenly monochrome. You see, the songs change. All these make tasks exciting. You know, you creativity is not the inheritance of the teacher to keep. Creativity is about getting others to work on their own. And that's what matters. You look at that. She had an imaginary door in which the father walks out. He's found somebody new, leaving the mother and the family behind. What images can you think of that you think that you only you can use, and the kids are actually having this door and the father is walking out? Whoa! And then suddenly the color changes to black and white, the song changes from happy to sad. And you know, the moment she used the past tense, it was a happy family. I said, okay, I'm going to look at some bad news along the way. But that's what it is. As a teacher, you're affected, but more so as a learner, there is a sort of catharsis you would get from a Shakespeare, watching a Shakespearean tragedy, you know. There's something that's been, you know, that gets up. And that is important. It's not about language learning alone. My students went on, and I'll tell you this, in all their blogs, they spent 2 hours on the technology, 2 weeks on the storyboarding and idea generation and things like that. So where, if you go to schools these days and say, my God, if it's technology, it's hard. No. They spend only 2 hours using Movie Maker, which is so accessible and free, right? And they spend 2 hours doing the storyboarding and the idea generation. So you look at that. A lot of time spent on thinking and working rather than on things like that. I want to lead you on to, how much time do we got?
8 minutes.
Huh? 8 minutes, just nice. I'm not going to show you everything. Actually, I got interesting stuff, real movies. You know what I did? I went to MRSM in Kuala Krai once, and I told them, okay, you all are Malay kids, Muslim kids, let's challenge you. I said, you have to imagine that you, some of you have to play the roles of Chinese, and some of you have to play the roles of Malays, and one of you falls in love with a Chinese or an Indian girl or you know, an intermarriage, and look at the conflicts within. You should watch. The wonderful thing about all these projects is the MRSM kids all have their videos now posted on YouTube. They have an international audience. And this goes back to the days when I did my MA in UKM, where, you know, people like Harriet Wong and all these people, they actually said, you know, Jaya, all this work on writing that our kids do, if you don't post them anywhere, on the walls and all that, they don't have an audience. If they don't have an audience, they are not published. Publishing is not about writing in a journal or a book or anything. Even if you look up the students' work on the walls, that's publishing. Of course, these days, blogs, Facebook, you name it, all my students' work, not just my university students' work, the work that my students were facilitators, all this MRSM Kuala Krai, MRSM Besut, and all this, they are all posted on YouTube now. I don't know which one to show, but it's so difficult to make decisions, but you watch this one.
Aku nak ilmu, baik tak?
Eh, jangan kira lah.
all these are Malay kids.
Young people like you, always playing with the laptop. Handphone, newspaper, got it? Got it or not?
Aiyah, I'm doing my homework.
Hey, Ben, you are always texting.
Nothing, Abah. Hello, boss.
Hey, Aha, look at your brother. What's wrong with you?
Let me go, Ma. It's big already. Don't worry, Ma.
These are Malay kids, no? All of them are Malay kids, okay? Got stick there in between. Don't worry, everything is taken care of. No animals were harmed at all as well. Values all the time, but kill kids with moral values, you know? It's like explicit teaching of moral values, but we tell them, look, okay, let's revisit Tangga. And my Chinese students told them whether his pronunciation or whether his Chinese accent in English is okay or not. Those are things that are amazing, isn't it? You get kids from Kuala Krai actually learning how to speak Chinese accent in English. You know, what's wrong with that? You know, we want them to be versatile with their language use. That's what we want. Some of these kids had sophisticated cameras and suddenly realized that when they want to do editing, because there was taking up so much of space, they couldn't work with sophisticated cameras. So they went back to their handphone cameras and their not so sophisticated digital cameras, and they learned so much about what's possible and what's not. Everything from the shooting, right from the storyboarding, right through the shooting to the editing, everything done by the students. And then on top of that, this publication is now on YouTube. Basically, what I want to tell you is, if you feel that language teaching is going to suffer because some of the things are not in place, you as a teacher trainer, I believe that there are only three levels. First, you train your students who are at the university, who are going to be future teachers. And the next level is to get them involved in service learning, so these teachers also invest their own learning, and then the learners whom they deal with also, while going through service learning, get to invest in their own learning. So when you invest in your own learning, and then you use multiple methods, like, you know, not just storyboarding, maybe using more on the left side of the brain, but the moment you start acting and shooting and producing this, a lot of the right side of the brain. So with language teaching, the wonderful thing that people say about using both sides of the brain is that recall is a lot more powerful when you use both the left and the right brain. So thank you very much.